last lecture of the semester. And one that I've been looking forward to all semester. It is my pleasure to introduce our lecturer tonight, Stephan Jaklitsch, who I think, as most of you know, is also one of four visiting critics that we have here this semester. And he's doing an extraordinarily interesting project with his students in New Mexico, in an old volcano in New Mexico. And I'm looking forward to sitting on the final review for that project. Stephan Jaklitsch is a visiting critic here this fall. The focus of the studio is the design of various infrastructural components for a contemporary 21st century national park within the Valles Caldera National Preserve in northern New Mexico. Stephan is a founding partner in the New York-based firm of Jaklitsch, Gardner Architects. The firm was founded in 1998, and since then, Stephan has taken his practice on a studio focused on residential and commercial projects in the New York region to an award-winning architectural firm with a diverse international portfolio of work. I understand that your office has completed somewhat in excess of 200 projects now in the past 12 years or so, which is sort of extraordinary. The firm's work ranges from housewares to interiors to buildings to urban scale projects. Of particular note is the extraordinary body of work done for the Marc Jacobs fashion outlets worldwide. Stephan has been the exclusive architect for Marc Jacobs and to date has completed over 100 stores worldwide for Marc Jacobs. Jaklitsch Gardner Architects has received numerous design awards, including three from the American Institute of Architects. Their projects have been published globally in architectural and general interest publications and journals. Stephan's work has been exhibited in New York, Chicago, and London. A recently published monograph covering the first decade of the firm's work is entitled Stephan Jaklitsch, Habits, Patterns, Algorithms, 1998 to 2008. I like that title. In addition to running this practice, Stephan is also active in many professional organizations, including the Design Trust for Public Space, Open House New York, the Architectural League of New York, the Van Allen Institute for Architecture and Design, and Friends of the High Line. How do you find the time to do all of that, Stephan, I'd like to know. Stephan hails originally from Maryland. He received a Bachelor of Science degree in architecture from Georgia Institute of Technology and a master's degree from Princeton University. Please join me in welcoming Stephan Jaklitsch.
Title of tonight's lecture is Conditional, but I was not clear because Conditional might actually mean whether I was going to show up to it or not. I've been a trying time in the last week in New York. I'm here and hopefully everything works out. I think in Manhattan we're recovering parts of Brooklyn, Staten Island, and New Jersey. So tonight is also election night. It's probably going to be a very long night. So I think I'll talk about architecture. This is one of the very first projects I worked on. It's a studio in North Carolina near Asheville in Greenville. It's in the mountains. The clients were living part-time in New York City on Canal Street, as well as having a farm in two valleys this sort of pasture, and then this horse pasture with the stream along here, the main highway, and the entry drive. This was actually the horse pasture, is actually down here. The client gave me this graph paper drawing his builder, and it basically looked like this, without the answer. And it basically was, this is my studio, this is my wife's studio. And I want a woodworking studio, and she wants a ceramic studio. And there's certain conditions for her. Is she needs a kiln and a can for her down. Thinking this sort of mine and hers economy is a little strange. But I decided to run with it. And so every room on her studio had a complimentary when people move in his studio, so whether it was the structure, with the pier foundation, so the footing, the types of views of the access, whether controlled views or a little bit more open, the roof drainage, the roof gutter, his would have a valley, the fenestration, each move was a one. The first move was actually to slice off the end of her studio that would begin to respond to that pasture. Beginning to move the canopy and the views outside, which then the rest of the stream. The stair and the studio were mounted in this woodshop, and then sutured them together with the circulation zone between. This is the site. There's an existing farmhouse, not a very high bit of design. And then the new studio here with the slice off. The plan section, I mean, the plan move in her studio was marked with this vertical uplift of his studio that sort of began to mark the site as you began to load it and drive into the studio. You would be able to see this as well. And then the view from her studio. Literally, it's a collage of materiality, the corrugated steel. Her studio and the cedar and the closest in the frame of the work of the studio. And this is actually three computer drawings there. But I chose to keep them for a little bit of interest for you. This is a suture for you to the two studios. We gutter along the gutter of this studio. The front facade is actually a flat facade, which is basically a stage set off of which is a three-dimensional element and a canopy in that scale. The rear facade becomes a much more sculptural for itself. This is the suture point of that downspout and the juncture between those two studios. This is a 63-acre property in upstate New York in Columbia County. It was a site that had typical in the region. There had been farms that had been cleared. After the last ice age, there was a crumbled rock that was actually below the surface of the soil. And with frost heating many hundreds of years, decades, the rock would begin to fall off to the top of the surface. And as the farmers cleared the site, they would begin to stack these rocks along their boundary or their property. In this case, it would probably be a crisscross wooden fence. And the fence has since decomposed. The farmers moved off to the west where there was more easily farm land, and this has resorted back to forest. So this is the type of land that we were dealing with on the site. There was an existing house, log cabin, that actually burned down. The condition was basically cleared out, not unlike a golf course, with these two lakes and this log cabin perched precisely on top of the hill. And that was the view. And so we became interested in how to restore the site, begin to add back some of the vegetation that had been cleared away, and to deal with the stone wall, which became a threshold. This is the former house, which the contractor had been hired to blast with a polyurethane off of the old logs in the interior with a corn-based blast, and left it a little bit too long, sealed up the house, and I think regretted it. We began to do borings of the available, there's actually rock right underneath here, so we began to do borings to see where we could actually position this house. I wanted to move it down the hill, connect into that existing foundation, as if it were a sort of found ruin. And this is basically the only place on the site that we were able to operate. This was the program, two-bedroom house, 1,600 square feet, separated into living, dining room, kitchen, and then two bedrooms, bathroom. We began to look at this, using the stones within the site as if this this boundary wall, so that as you approach the site, it would only be visible as a wall, as if it were connected into that existing foundation. Split with the entry in between, and then the plant. So the dining area at the top actually is situated within the framework of the existing foundation, and with light exposure on two sides, and the view out into the valley. All of this is really about delayed gratification, the system of thresholds, with the view denied until you actually approach the house, pass through it, through that breach in the wall with the foundation of the previous house in the background. This is the view of that dining room from within that foundation, perched as if it was this key ritual of dining right there. And then the view to the landscape with the entry right behind the kitchen as you come around. So the view opens up in front of you all of a sudden. The view of the bedroom, bath, and then living room, which seems to be out of sequence. Sorry about that. Back on the outside, we shifted it down from the peak of the hill and nestled it back into the site, and we put the foundation level, or the level really, even with the level of the previous foundation. This house was a renovation of an existing house, which had really been a series of houses built up over time on the tip of Cape Cod in Provincetown. You can see the tidal flats here with the jetty really here, which permits the tides to come in and out. The house is actually just beyond that area, situated. Due to the zoning, has now been superimposed on top of each other. But we had to have two kitchens to maintain that double property. And we were dealing with a fishing village in a sense that's also become a seaside resort of Provincetown. Most of the houses are much smaller scale than this. This is a 6,000 square foot house. So one of the challenges was really dealing with the massing of that. This was the original house built within 1870. It is not what they call a floater. A floater, actually, it seems to work intermittently. Okay. There we go. Okay, thank you. So the houses were actually out here until the storm of 1938. Was referred to as the Long Island Express. So a hurricane that came up the East Coast, plowed through Long Island, and then went into Cape Cod. So a lot of these houses had been moved into the town directly.
and they are a sensitive issue with landlords. This house was not what they call a floater. They actually picked up the houses, put them on barges, and moved the whole town inland to protect it from the future storms. So this is the first clapboard cedar shingle house. Typically, it's clapboard along the front and then cedar shingle on the sides. And then the second property was started about 1920. And this house eventually grew through a series of accretions into a single family residence, although zoned for two families. And then up through the 1970s, and then the additions which we made, we actually removed the decking, and so we did not actually increase the footprint technically, we decreased it, but these are non-permeable areas that we were dealing with. The concern was how to sort of break up that massing and to deal with some of the existing bits of the house or the adjacent neighbors and to sort of celebrate that jumble along the waterfront, but yet to try to instill some level of order. We chose to follow the system of accretion and to embrace it. And so instead of masking it in the historicism of the existing house, which the town actually was pushing us to do, and which the client was actually pushing us to do, we slowly convinced the client over many years, and I think Rob was giving me grief the other night because of how long this house actually took. It's about a four-year process. Part of that was there were three major redesigns during the construction phase in which we were actually trying to educate the client and bring them along. So the new rear part of this house in which we were actually changed the cladding, we wanted it to register as a new infill, not the existing cedar shingle or the clapboard. So in effect, we're removing the old part of the house and replacing it with this. Now what happened was, we found out that there's no foundation. So what they used to do was build in the 1930s, turning the CMUs on their side, setting them in the dune. There was no masonry. So we were able to get an emergency order to basically have all of it, except for this garage, torn down. Very controversial, but we had to rebuild following this ridge line with the street facade maintained as it was. This was the actual increase, removing the original, the decking that had been added in the 1970s, including this pier that had been out into the water. We rebuilt that seawall and then increased the mass of that part of the house. So it was a bit of a trade-off. The previous house had also been gutted and sort of slathered with 12 by 12 inch white Carrara marble on almost every surface, chandeliers that came down to about a foot off the floor. It was vulgar. Literally. There was an open plan. Structurally, it was problematic because the house was actually sinking and leaking. We had to the strategy was actually, let me back up a minute. The previous entry had been here. The historic entry had been in the 1870 house. We actually shifted the entry and the circulation spine here with the cross circulation. Suturing together all of these properties and various bits. We chose to maintain smaller scale rooms along that street front and open it up to the bayside. Partly we were able to do that through the steel structure that was introduced. So this is the original house actually in the process of demolition. This was the piers that were already beyond the seawall, which eventually never had been. These were all removed. This is the new steel going in with the existing fragment of that bedroom volume on the right. And then the new library, which is actually, it's really the hinge of the house. It's the only room that connects front to back. and framing of that view, which is that is the lighthouse's very tip of Hitchcock. And the former pier, which was being removed, and the view from one floor down, looking out, this is during high tide. And the house under construction, and that nearing completion with the new seawall, which was then raised. And then, so the exterior, we chose a cedar and mahogany framing of the living room volume, and then the bedroom volume repeats that, which separates it and distinguishes it from the rest of the house. That's the rear decking. The street side, complete contrast. We had to maintain that street line and then the original volumes. We shifted the entry away from this library into just around the corner right there. And this is the original 1870 portion, except that it's really from 2007. The proportions were actually corrected back to a historic cape. The windows that you'll see in a second are actually right down here. And there's a significant shift in the section of the hillside. New cape windows, which were back to the original proportion. And to contrast the windows from the street side with their with double hung window fenestration with those view of the sea beyond. So we were able to open up the back of the house and to distinguish the two types of fenestration based on the two sides of our house. The client had actually wanted a wall right here in an extensive art collection. And that took, I think, about 10 months to argue that there should actually not be a wall right there. And it really took the framing of the house itself to be able to convince him of that. And just turning that window around the corner just a little bit, and then its counterpart on this other side, which continues down the stair. As you come into the living room, you step down two steps, which is then reflected in that handrail. And then continues downstairs, which then opens up sliding to the rear yard and to the sea. Downstairs entry from the sea into the rear kitchen, and then actually back up on the roof, the rear facade, that new seawall, and the view from the sea with the tide going out at dusk. So you begin to see the massing as it's kind of that strategy work through there. So Tokyo. There's a Marc Jacobs flagship in Ono Montesano, next to the Brava flagship. This is the Meiji Shrine with the Yoyogi Stadium here by Kenzo Tange. Street for the shrine that then had been residential in the last 100 years and in the last 10 years has become a series of shops, Dior, Isana, and MDRBB, a number of other shops that you all know, I'm sure, and then terminating in the Prada epicenter of which we were adjacent to. So it's a complex neighborhood. This is the extension of that Motosando Dori, the Prada epicenter, in which the massing went higher and they created that courtyard, Miu Miu, and then the rest of this is actually residential street. And this is the site itself with Cartier in the corner. And so part of the problem is if this is all of the traffic, how for our clients do we get some of the traffic and begin to redirect? This is the site itself, situated between Cartier and Prada. This was to be our site. The zoning permitted really one or two floors occupiable. And the zoning laws in Tokyo are rather complex. And there are things as shadow lines, which I will get into. And so it became a whole game to try to interpret this and see what we were actually able to get away with. Through the analysis, we were able to find out we could double the height of the building if it was not occupied. But to do that, you had to maintain a 500 millimeter gap. And so the strategy really became, how do you create this monolith and obscure that gap? And this actually took up a great deal of our time trying to think through how to solve this problem and to fight it. These are two examples of that 500 millimeter gap in other buildings, what they call a kosokubutsu or ghost wall. It'd be advertising typically. In our case, we were also looking to use it for advertising, but we did not want that line to be. This is the zoning diagram for the site. Now, you could have a building actually shaped like this and all occupied. The theory is that the protrusion on top of the building in the unoccupied zone does not actually cast a shadow. It seems bizarre to me, and I couldn't really understand that. I kept saying this logic does not actually work, but of course it actually cast a shadow. It was a physical presence. And they said, no, actually, if it doesn't. And I said, okay, so we will work around this, okay? So this was the actual occupiable massing of the building, and then we began to look at it, and what if we begin to mask it? And what if we cut out that ground floor? And so we began to look at alternate strategies following along through that, playing off a number of different ideas. One is that you would see the service on the interior. This is literally, what if we camouflage the whole thing? What if we just accept that that is the occupiable portion, the rest of it becomes unoccupiable, but we have a screening on the entire outside. So the first strategy was really the series of louvers that might expand and contract, open up, and which it is all about masking that. And so it's not unlike a dress being lifted. And so then the section of how that might work with that kosokubutsu or ghost wall on the top, section of that. And various permutations in the studies until we got to this point when I drew the line and said, okay, stop, no more. We can't do this, this is not working. We exhausted every possibility. And I went for the wall in the Imperial Gardens because I was about to, as sort of at the end of what I felt I could do with that strategy. I stood staring at this wall actually, for the better part of an afternoon. It was a very nice wall to look at. Everything about it is artificial. From the moat to the dry stack wall to this course right here in the stone, and then the stucco on top, the repetitive tiles, the vegetative line, and then of course the vegetation, which is all with scissors and metal ladders, and then that ridge line in the background. And I began to actually think about this and how we might then apply this to this building and what lessons might be derived. So remove the screen, embrace the tripartite structure, what I considered a pattern, a texture, and then a void, which actually led to this, which is the actual building. So we have the lantern on top, this textured sample, it's almost like a core sample, pulling it out of the earth and opening it up on the ground floor and void to connect it to the street. So this is what was actually built. The structure on the exterior is actually relatively inexpensive. It is flat aluminum panels that are perforated with an LED lighting and a tent fabric behind. This is a concrete base, which you'll see in the section, and then a terracotta tile. And then this is probably the most expensive portion, is the glass, in which we did everything we can to eliminate any barrier between the sidewalk and the interior. The floor plan. So this is a fire zone, and this is a fire zone. We accepted that wall and made the rest of this dematerialize and then the standard that goes up. This vitrine then becomes a fire separation between the stair and the rest of the store. And then the interior upstairs, again, there's a fire shutter here, and a fire shutter here, and the whole second floor is a fire zone, which I'll explain in a second. Tokyo, if you read Tokyo Metabolizing, Yoshi Tanahara lays out that first, Paris is the imperial city, and Manhattan might be the capitalist city, and Tokyo is the metabolizing city. And by that, it is a city in which the life history, life expectancy of any building is maybe 26 years. It is one of the shortest of any of the developed countries, Germany, France, United States, Britain. And so basically, these buildings last 26 years. You tear them down, you subdivide the zone, and you build a new building. But every building is a freestanding building. As such, there's usually a separation between you and the adjacent neighbor. But as such, your buildings had to embrace the separation from the neighbor, in this case, it's Cartier, and then the entire second floor. And so, again, one of the challenges that we had to deal with in terms of planning, we opted to actually acknowledge that and make that building read as such. So this is this sort of blank textured facade. We handled this with a wired glass and then the optical clear glass. And so you can actually read these zones in a rather subtle way. The first portion of this is the tile, the terracotta tile. We began to work with a company in Tokyo, Max, which is the equivalent of Toto. They both compete, they both make books, they both make toilets, they both make porcelain. They seem to compete head-to-head in whatever industry. But we began working with the Max. And they began to look at the shape of this. They had a similar product in which we asked them to blow this up and scale to work in the exterior condition. Their other tile was prepared for the interior condition. And then it was given color, and how do you actually take this and break it, and then use this thing as a sort of bespoke tile on it. And then because of the way we had to develop a clip system that actually ties back. But doing so, we were able to then, this is the actual rain screen into the concrete and then the waterproofing, create about an inch barrier, which acts as a, it's a chimney effect. So the tile is actually a shaving ice for the building on the upper floors. And then the hot air lines are behind it. So one of the better insulating materials we could have found. This is the corner condition in which we're actually trying to stagger to resolve that, given that we have a fixed unit. And then that is a corner condition as built. And then the lantern, which is the second part, began to look at this in terms of the exoskeleton. In this case, this is a Chinese lantern. The wire twisted provides the structure itself, and then the paper in the interior. And this is a building outside of the castle by Plechnik and Prague that I had seen. Is completely flat, planar surface with this three-dimensional illusion. We had to wrestle with, these are the fish scales that become part of that perforated screen and the geometry is on that. There are actually two types of tiles. And then those tiles fit within a larger panel, and then that panel type gets replicated. This is a wraparound of the entire upper screen, so there's no vertical stitch. There is a difficult little while to work out, but this is the expansion from the expansion joint, and then this is the juncture between the individual panels, and these are the panel types. So there's a limit to how many panel types we were actually permitted, because it is actually a developer building. And so there's also, since these are self-cleaning and they had to fit within the bath, they had to be constrained to a certain dimension. And so we're going to stitch these together to create a larger panel and then fit within this overall, and then wrap it around. And so there's no vertical joints. Shop drawings, which they become a little combative with the developer to actually get what we wanted. You begin to see the juncture on the corner panel. Mock-up and then the juncture. And so by inflecting this and turning it back, we're able to stiffen that panel and add structural reinforcement. From the detail with the parallel and seismic juncture. The third portion was actually that ground floor void, in which I had said we had done everything we could to eliminate any transit barrier, extended the material on the floor out into the sidewalk as a flaking granite so that it deals with rain and slippery conditions. We lowered the proportion of this to 3 meters precisely, which is the height of the glass we could get without any reinforcement. Within, behind, or volume. The only volume is actually at that fire glass. This worked a little too well, and I'll explain that in a minute. And then the sequence through, in effect, the facade got pushed back, the very clear facade, in a way, enticed you to come in. So it's as if the facade is really at cash wrap. If the three parts of the building may speak, the top might sing, the beacon, the middle part might be mute, this may whisper seductively. And so we actually get people running in and running into class, and unfortunately we had devised a solution for that. I was in a battle with the Japanese CEO who wanted to take the script down to show the merchandise. That he would get more customers the higher we were on with the scripts, and we created a sense of mystery. Finally, we went out. This vitrine is actually a fire screen, and there are little hydraulic panels here that lower in case of a smoke barrier. And there are two fish tanks at the insistence of the client. This one, the blades are taken down, so it's actually suspended structurally from the bottom. Somewhat gratuitous, but there were two requests. I mean, the fish tank was one of them, the other was going to be a black and white building. That's all I had to deal with, and everything else were the constraints of the site, and the physical constraints of the zoning and so forth. The transition from levels of interiority from the stone that continues into the sidewalk to the wood landing, and then going up the stair, meshed in between the vitrine and the interior, the handrail, and then the transition to the carpet upstairs. And then back down. There's at the very last minute, they wanted the men's store in the basement, which had been storage. And so there was a complete redesign pretty much at the last minute. But this sense of stratification then continues within that basement stone. To solve the problem, the people running into that screen, we designed a print pattern in which we decided that to do this sort of visual noise pattern, which might be, we went through these various options until we worked our way out until the final one was selected. And the noise gets a little louder at the most precise points where the clients are most likely to run into that glass. And then the final one that was selected in the installation. And the problem with the site was really how to deal with this monster of the building right here. And the residential buildings here, as well as the other commercial structures. And so it really is as if you're building in a city in which they're tearing down buildings every 26 years. You have to anticipate the next few moves. It became a little bit of a chess game. And so there were the zoning restrictions, there are the other number of restrictions, but then there had to be this urban strategy in which we were trying to figure out how to work with a building that would stand up for a period of time. Video of the site. This is really about construction sequence in some ways. Not one-to-one, but you're about to get the fish tank in a second. There you go. And so all my students are going to be expected to do this for their final presentation. To actually relocate that security gate back beyond the fire screen, the freight elevator, and to open up that front area as a gallery. And it really becomes a series of thresholds moving from the very gritty neighborhood of the street through these various thresholds into the store itself, and then the sort of chimney area, and then the designer studio. The materiality and the forms begin to shift as you move back through this space. So we were able to open up this entire facade, create this gallery, create a security barrier here, have another transition zone, and then this is really the retail area, and then two fitting rooms, and then that design. Existing condition, actively carved out a little bit, dealing with the new storefront and the window canopy, fitting rooms, and the curtain linear form, which is sort of the counterpoint to that existing interior. That is the original storefront, and then we were able to open up, convincing the client and the landlord to allow cutting off the mass of cast iron with the delicacy of the cinder film. This, in effect, became the real sign of the store. So you get this first threshold, the first little bit of gallery, that security barrier, and then this sort of diaphanous veil back to with the crew back to the changing areas. And then looking back out to the street. Marc Jacobs, this is the first project I did for them. And it was, in many ways, a matter of trying to interpret what their brand was about. And when I met with Marc Jacobs' business partner, Robert Duffy, first thing he said was, this is not Gucci, this is not Fendi, this is an extremely subtle brand. And there might be a product such as a wedding ring in which the diamond is inside, there's a trap door, and only you or the person wearing this actually knows about this. Or a cashmere sweater, which is really a thermal tee. It became really about those in the know. So it became really a very subtle counterpoint to the Louis Vuitton, which Marc was actually designing for as well at the same time. The street in San Francisco is Main Lane, which is all the Union Square. It's the street of Chanel, the Seven, and so forth. With the echo right in, opposite. And the elevation changes quite a bit from Union Square down toward the Embarcadero. This is a drop hole. And so the floors are never quite aligned with the street level. And most of them are screened in some ways. And so we actually chose to play off of that by the strategy of contrast to the other stores in our series of facade studies. Steel frame was again the first threshold. The screen client really wanted it opened up. But there had to be a giving it all away. We had to develop these series of thresholds and continue it. And it was a very subtle approach to do this. They're almost imperceptible, actually. It's through markings on the floor or in the ceiling or on the wall or the arrangement of the furniture is really the strategy of either seducing you to lure you into the store or inducing you to pause and to take a moment. Matidis in the 50s was actually a genius at this, and much to be learned from looking at his work. But it is true that people are drawn to light, and this sort of skylight in the back, which is canted and proportionally marked off, begins to really serve as the anchor for the store. This was a matter of taking language for an existing brand. They had one other store that had a black floor, white wall, and that was essentially it. And it was a bit of a grunge brand at the time. And trying to develop this language for them and then to apply it to any number of different stores around the world in different typologies. This became the problem that consumed us for the next few years. The Bleecker Street, there was nothing here. This was the site at Bleecker and 11th. This had been a doctor's office. There was graffiti here. It was a historic photo. And this is the only reason I was permitted to open it at that corner. It's a fight with landmines in which we were able to demonstrate that there was likely a column in this corner, and there was likely a cast iron column here. And I could not prove it unless they allowed me to at least tear down the wall to show them that it was there. So, of course, it does turn out that there is a column in this position. We opened this up, carved it away, exposed that threshold about a foot deep, and expressed that within
the treatment of materials in the interior. But then it became a matter of applying the lessons in San Francisco here, and in a much smaller space. So there is this tension between this embrasure, which the ceiling and the wall become one in the triangle of view, and then addressing the corner, and then dealing with this kind of one view situation. So there's this sort of artificial axial arrangement, but it is really the sort of link in the principle that's operating here. So you can really see that structural cut, and that's better here in the photo that we show it very well. I really wanted to get rid of those. This is also supposed to be blank. And then to counterbalance that symmetry with the asymmetry of the furniture, you can see a little bit better. And then they're now 8 stores on Bleecker Street. So it becomes this urban strategy, these tiny little stores with no storage, and how to unify them, but also it's this sort of critical mass of everything operation. This was it's an 1812 wood frame building that then got stuccoed, and it was near collapse, actually. It was just about to collapse when we took it over. And the whole point of this was to be a storage facility for the other store. And so I go in and I said, did anyone look at the basement? And they said, no, why? Did you sign the lease? And they said, yes. The basement's 2 feet deep. It's a crawl space. And so we actually had to underpin. We had to take a foundation. We had to underpin this whole thing. And the whole thing was eaten by termites. It was wood frame construction. And we had to rebuild it. And it took about a year to do so. But we were able to clean out a number of the columns to do so. So this is actually the solid stone brazier, which is a counterpoint to that sort of fragile intervention on the interior. We were able to open this up, insert the lighting within the ceiling, which I'll show you in a minute, register the columns. It was a very tiny space, and it was a matter of then being in different programs, being accessories, registering it differently from the ready-to-wear down the street. And so we actually had to register every single joist with the bathtub upstairs that was causing that deflection, and inserting the lights in between, the fireproofing between the residential and the zoning structural with a new footing and foundation. Becomes completely abstract, boundaryless space, and very tiny. It's that lighting again. It's really the rear wall and then that table that are anchoring the space. So through time, the language of the brand began to evolve. They began to add other merchandise. And it became a matter of how to devise a design that could be accommodated in any number of different facilities. This is the Pelle Ramp. And it is a historic structure built in 1680. It's actually a timber frame structure, plaster. It's what some French person said to me. This is all fake. What was amazing when you opened it up, you actually saw this entire palimpsest of the history of the structure, from the cast iron, the strapping, the timber, with the axe mark, and concrete walls. Both of these have a shop in front and an office in back. There are these individual bays. Client had been able to assemble 7 bays of this, and the program is to be women, men, and stitch them together with this accessories carrier. And we were trying to negotiate the opening of the wall onto the street. So every negotiation
one thing I lost on was this wall. They began to think through the Walmart coming into Paris and to the Australian culture. So they would not allow this fragment to be torn down. I did get it reduced, so I was able to open this up to about 3 meters. But this was the one hole down, which would somehow leave for the future that someone could arrive at what they were doing in these spaces. Because we would open this up, the new structure, the steel columns, allow new steel to appear. I created a completely new look. We did work with them on a whole new facade concept, which is then going to apply throughout the Palais Royal. This is the new standard. It was an 18th century standard, it was a 19th century standard. This is the 20th century standard. So given the odd geometry, given that we're trying to unify the space through this rhythm of opening out the structure and then creating this the dematerial the wall to the garden, that view really took you out to that garden, the new facade, and the ceiling, and then the rhythm and the millwork that snaked through that really unified the entire district geometry and further. The ceiling was one of the final points, which I'll show you in a second. Lighting scheme. Every bay, this entire, there's no square corner in the 1680 building. Every bay is a unique shape. They're all parallelograms. It became a complex geometry between the flatness of the perimeters, accommodating the structure, and then trying to capture the sense of space in between. I was trying to find an architectural element that would serve in both the contemporary would serve as a complement to the existing historical structure. We do not want something historic in nature. There was that flat condition in front, and then these were all hand cast fiberglass reinforced ceiling. So the wood-frame structure, the new steel, an existing cast iron column that had been added previously, and then the new plaster cast in the ceiling. There's one more layer into the historic building. And then the air conditioning was all snaked through here. And then the rear back down the accessory. So really all the reflective materiality was to sort of make this wall go away, dematerialize it, and then the ceiling was an attempt to capture the space and contain the space. So it was this tension between the two. Wrapping up, there's this last little bit of the lecture are three little things that have meant a lot to me over the years. This is actually texture. And what is significant about it, when you can see the contrast to the next building, is really the series of transitions in the materiality and the cues of the material to behavior. There's a psychological component to all of this. Associate Dean, talking far more about this tonight, but there is a, you arrive, there's stonework, there is stone. You remove your shoes on as you begin to step up to the wood, and then that layer to the tatami. And as you walk into the tatami and you enter the room, there's another wind threshold. And each threshold begins to cue you as to whether you can take off your slippers, or to switch to the toilet slippers, or to wear your street shoes. The architectural cues are all there for you to be able to read. Next one. Okay, my hero. So your reverence. grumpy old man. Chauffeur, who was actually driving his best photo of him. He's actually working on a European church here, in which he's actually taking out bricks and setting them in place and working with the masons directly, which precisely he wanted each of the building materials to do so. The Stockholm Cemetery, in which he collaborated with Asplund, becomes a transition of sorts for himself through his entire career, from the 1915 competition up through the 1940s when he completed the last building of this particular cemetery. But the separation between the cemetery and the adjacent residential neighborhoods, the roughness of the wall, the spruce and the pine, the entry, his language changes throughout. So I'm actually envisioning this one particular chapel, you know, the Resurrection Chapel, and I'll walk you through the sequence. But the contrast between the refinement and then the roughness and this anticipation of something that might be heat. And what he's really dealing with is a transition from life to the afterlife. And as you did the planning, but there's the way of the cross up to Aspen's Church, and then on top of the hill is superimposed, and all of this language of the Nordic, the pagan, the neoclassical, and the Christian. And all of this is working together, so he has this world of remembrance on top of this mound, which is using the particular site that had been a gravel quarry. That is in reference to previous burial mounds of Swedish kings. So immediately there's this tension between the way of the cross, the Aspen's Chapel, and the way of the seven vows that then leads down to the Chapel of the Resurrection. The chapel between these two. The elms at the top with that rather linear bench that frames that road of remembrance. And the path all the way down, you begin to see in the pentagon the resurrection of Christ here, the passage through the forest. And this chapel, there are actually two buildings. This one, oriented crank, to address this long axis, and the other one, dealing east to west for religious purposes, is the ceremony of the rite of passage itself. This is just as people who come in. This is actually an independent structure from the chapel itself, with the tallness and that austerity that he's shifted the language as he developed this from a little bit more of one dealing with pathos to one that is more celebratory in nature. This is the footing as you come in. This is raised. This is elevated just slightly. This is a moment in which the person passing through this comes to a pause. And that architecture tells you right there, you feel it, you don't necessarily see it, you can't quite perceive it other than actually you feel it under your feet. This is monumental entry. You go through these divertees from the door, you enter into the chapel, it's illuminated to the altar. And then there's the ceremony. And then you pass through rather unceremonious. This one actually captures it. You have dealing with this life and then dealing with the next life. And then this enters into the positive down into one of the gravel pits. And this gets you to our final slide, which is a photograph I have above my office, my desk in the office. It's a type of monument. A Cuban American photographer and thinking of Cooper-Hewitt and dealing with impermanence. And yet there is something celebratory about this, that the detritus could be seen as the equivalent of the desert prayer shawl. There's something helpful that crystallizes a trash can actually be seen to raise. Anyway, this is really all about a sense of impermanence, and yet there is
the only question for Stephan, please go raise your hand. We have a microphone that we can pass around.
Do you approach retail and residential differently through process?
No, we don't. There's actually something very similar in scale between the two. And maybe it's the nature of our first clients in retail. Before that, San Francisco store never actually designed a retail store, which is something I tried to convince people when they don't want to hire us because we've never done a different typology. Client wanted a living room, and the sense of detail is—it's a little bit—it's a delicate balance between what might be a commercial thing and what might be a residential thing. But we don't distinguish between the product types. It's architecture. We design product design. We treat it the same way. We have urban schemes. We've done some competitions. We view design as design. From the very tiniest scale up to the largest scale.
Thank you for your presentation. Really fascinating work, and we can see the detail and the intense work that you put into it. You mentioned a couple of times the relationship between you and the client, and I was wondering in that process, what are the principles that you take when you try to convince the client taking one of your ideas, and when do you listen to the client, and what kind of process do you have in trying to convince the client of taking this?
Interesting question. I think it always depends on the client, but some of my clients are very forceful personalities, and some of them appreciate the pushback and the reasoning. You have to articulate why you believe something is better than something else. You have to show them, you have to demonstrate, and you have to listen. You have to show respect. I mean, these are educated people who are decisive, and if you were able to demonstrate, just as you were able to demonstrate in each of your designs, and you're trying to convince your faculty why it is that your design should be the way it is, it's no different with any client. You have to argue for it, and you have to express your opinion. Sometimes it's a little bit more difficult, and it takes time, and sometimes you can't push it. And there are subtle ways of doing it over time. We can sort of return to an issue, maybe 6 months later, maybe 18 months later, and then begin to say, okay, so you've really begun to annoy me after a year of this. What is it that you're really trying to get at? And then you know that they may actually listen at that point. But not always. It's, any design is a collaboration, so it's not just me. It's an office of 20 people, and it's contractors and subcontractors who all know their craft and their skills, and the clients that bring something to the table. The clients adding something to the design only makes it better, I think. I think you can only have a good project if you have a good client. And if you don't have a good client, you're not going to have a good project, no matter how good you are. That really is the core issue, because a client who will push you can take you places that you may not have expected. That was always said about Thomas Krenz and Frank Gehry on Bilbao. Krenz kept pushing him. I said, I need something more. I need something to attract millions of people and go back to the table and come back with something. So you have to have that relationship with any client.
Thank you. that video that you showed about the project in Tokyo at the very end, well, sorry, the project in the middle, but the video at the end, why did you make that? Did the client request it, or were you trying to persuade them of something?
Primarily that was for the client to explain to them the sequence, the various components of the building in a way. It's also, by that point we had already done the set of models and we had done other things, and so it was also explaining to, we had several layers of clients. We had a client in Tokyo who was the landlord, we had a client in Tokyo who was the CEO of the local subsidiary, which was a joint venture, we had a client in New York, Marc Jacobs and Robert Duffy, and we had to begin to explain things to each of them.